And joining us now on the debate for the full hour tonight, in Chicago, Illinois, Donald Cox, Global Strategy Advisor at BMO Financial Group. In New York, New York, Agnes Crane, Financial Columnist at Reuters Breaking Views. In Victoria, British Columbia, Paul Somerville, Adjunct Professor at the Peter Gustavson School of Business at the University of Victoria. And with us back here in studio, Brian Milner, Senior Economics Writer at the Globe and Mail. And it's a pleasure to have everybody on the program. Paul, Donald, we've had you on before. Agnes, good to have you on for the first time. And of course, Brian,
it's good to be
a
here.
Fixture in these parts, if I can say. Let me start by just, we're going to go through some graphics here. And I want to read how things were before the Great Recession hit and how they are now. Some of these names people may not remember. Top five U.S. investment banks in 2008, as measured by assets. Number one, Goldman Sachs. Number two, Morgan Stanley. Number three, Merrill Lynch. Number four, Lehman Brothers. Number five, Bear Stearns. Fast forward only 4 years, and let's take a look at what's happened. The top five now, J.P. Morgan Chase. Assets in 2008, more than $2.1 trillion. Assets now, $2.3 trillion. Number two, Bank of America. Assets then, $1.8 trillion. Assets now, more than $2 trillion. Number three, Citigroup. Assets then, $1.938 trillion. Assets now, $1.944 trillion. Number four, Wells Fargo. This list looks different. Assets then, $1.31 trillion. Assets now, $1.33 trillion. And finally, number five, Goldman Sachs. Assets in 2008, $885 billion. Assets now, $951 billion. All the biggest banks are even bigger. Let's start with why. Donald Cox, let's get some theories on the table here. Why are these banks, despite the past 4 years, all bigger?
Well, you've had some mergers in there. And basically, one of the things about dead banks is that they do leave some useful remains, unlike other things that die. And so what you had was that J.P. Morgan was able to pick up a collapsed savings and loan institution. And that sort of thing went on. But the other reason for it is because the Federal Reserve has expanded its own balance sheet unbelievably and pumped money out into the system. And a lot of that ends up as bank reserves for these organizations. So you can say that at the same time that the system was imploding, the Fed was trying to pump it up successfully, as it turned out. And so that ends up as being deposits with the Fed on the balance sheets. This is a sort of a rubber band relay operation between the Fed and the banks. And you can say, therefore, that that's part of how it works. That was the part that did work.
Agnes, would you add anything to that list?
Yeah, I mean, I would also, you know, just add, just to build on the fact that, I mean, we did see a dramatic consolidation during the crisis, right? I mean, it wasn't just J.P. Morgan picking up Washington Mutual. It also picked up remnants of Bear Stearns. You know, Bank of America picked up Merrill Lynch when we had Wells Fargo picking up Wachovia. And so, again, I mean, as part of the crisis, that's what, you know, you had this kind of consolidation. And then I think since the crisis, what's been happening, too, is that every time you kind of get like flight to quality, you know, when investors or depositors get nervous about, you know, what the world looks like, they look at these five banks and feel comfortable, you know, putting their money there because they're so big. And I think, you know, we still have this perception that they're so big that they're not going to go anywhere.
Paul, you know, as you look then versus now, it's only a four-year period of time. Has there, I mean, you're a student of history and you teach this stuff, has there been a time when the top five then, and just a few years later, the top five now look so different? Has that ever happened before?
Well, if it did happen, it would have happened sometime between 1929 and in 1934. When you have the kind of structural adjustment to an industry, which happened to financial services after the 2008 breakdown, you would expect that kind of result that we have now, which is a rearranging of the players, a kind of Darwinian type of consequence, where the players that actually survive end up bigger, partly, as Donald suggested, eating the remains of the companies that that didn't survive. But at the same time, that companies are also repositioning themselves to take advantage of the sectors of the business that survived, so that they actually become healthier. So this isn't an unusual event when you have the kind of structural adjustment that we had in 2008.
Brian, the mantra a few years ago was that institution is too big to fail. We can't let it fail. We have to rescue it with taxpayers' money, etc. I'm not sure people thought 4 years later that these banks, which then were too big to fail, would be even bigger. Is this a good thing?
Well, the bigger they get, the more likely it is that they'll make mistakes, because that tends to happen in these big institutions. They feel that it doesn't matter if they make these small billion or $2 billion mistakes. And we saw that with J.P. Morgan, the heavy losses, and the CEO goes, "Yeah, that's just, you know, $2-4 billion. I don't have to worry about that because my bank is so big and powerful." I think there are risks when they get too big to fail. I mean, Paul Volcker has said we should never let them get too big to fail, but it's too late. The problem that the Americans have is that they allowed one of those too big to fail banks to fail. That was Lehman Brothers. They just decided, no, we're gonna rescue Bear Stearns by forcing a merger. We're gonna force mergers with all these others, but this one we're gonna make an example of and prove that we believe in capitalism doing what it's supposed to do, and we're gonna let that happen. So sure enough, Lehman goes down, and we saw the consequences: a global credit collapse, a freeze in the markets, billions and billions of dollars taken out of the banks overnight, and the money market funds collapsing. That's the fear if they allow any of these institutions, and there have been 29 designated around the world by regulators as too big to fail today.
Donald, if that's a good characterization, and I think it probably is, of what's gone down over the past 4 years, it suggests that the blame for the current situation lies, I guess, if you're going to make a list, at the top, with the then Treasury Secretary, who kind of ordered this rationalization to take place. Is that where you'd put the blame first and foremost?
Well, first of all, I don't think you can blame any single individuals. Remember, this was a true crisis, and everybody was involved in it, including Tim Geithner, Hank Paulson, those people. They were lucky if they got 3 hours sleep a night for weeks. What they went through was equivalent to a real battlefield situation. And it's easy to second guess what they did now. But frankly, I think that nobody understood the dimensions of this. It was, if you'd gone back to the Depression, when a small Austrian bank called Credit Anstalt went down, and to everybody's amazement, that drove was the final sort of nails in the coffin in creating a global depression, because the tentacles reached out. In this case, the sheer scale of these organizations that were in trouble was such that, yeah, there was a potential of going into a brand new depression, and it was too late to go back to pre-Glass-Steagall stage. So I'm very critical of the way the banks have behaved. My term for them is the big bad bonus bailout banks. That's how I refer to them. And I'm critical of how they're compensated, all those things. But still, at that time, you did have to save them, because Lehman was not considered, as you say, that big a deal. And it nearly brought us down. And you read the accounts written by these individuals of what they went through as they were rescuing it. My attitude is they should all get some kind of distinguished service medal, not because everything they did was right, but because not one of those people involved in the rescuing ever did anything really immoral. I mean, they acted in really patriotic fashion. Furthermore, we also established terrific connections between Canada and the U.S. and with Britain. And those connections proved very valuable going forward. So I think actually this was the closest thing since D-Day of that kind of sense of people behaving heroically in something that they didn't really know what they were getting into.
Paul, who would you blame for the fact that the once huge banks are even huger now?
Well, I think it's important to put the whole conversation in historical context. And that is that at the very moment that the regulatory impulse of the state was kind of doing this, declining, I guess since Reagan and Thatcher in the early 1980s, that the global financial industry was doing this because of new technologies. And it was an industry that benefited from revolutions in other sectors of the economy, principally information, communication, and transportation. And so at the moment that the financial services industry was exploding as a size of the economy, for example, in terms of market cap and the S&P, typically financial services were about 6 to 8%. By 2007 and 2008, it was closer to 22-23%. So the financial services industry became this colossal beast at the very same time that states around the world, because of the belief that the market is always right, the invisible hand of the market, that market outcomes are always just, that the state should back up and give the financial sector room really to do what it wanted. The problem was that on the whole, the financial services, the leaders of the financial services industry didn't really understand the risks that were embedded in the products that were being developed, not by people of their generation, but by a different generation, a much younger generation rooted in highly technical, mathematical approaches to developing financial services and financial products. So I would actually put a lot of blame at the heels of the presidents and the compliance officers and even the people running the businesses who really didn't understand the embedded risk. As Donald has said, the extraordinary efforts, even though some of their decisions one may not agree with, of regulatory authorities to try to tackle this beast as it was eating up the global economy in 2008 and early 2009, they're actually, I think, they're ones you do need to thank, because it was pretty selfless. But at the end of the day, it was the combination of these two historical changes. One, the regulatory impulse of the state collapsing, and the rise of financial services as a complicated and difficult to understand industry.
Okay, Agnes, having heard that now, we are actually getting a bit of a list together with, you know, several names on it now for who we want to blame. Is there anybody that you want to add to the list for the fact that these banks are now even bigger today than they were?
And this is the thing. I mean, I think, like, when we play the blame game, I mean, I think there's a lot of blame. And one point where I would disagree is I do think, you know, regulators did have a part in this. I mean, they were essentially not doing their job before the crisis, right? I mean, I also like share the other panelists' view that I think they did an amazing job during the crisis, and I think everybody was working at, you know, off the seat of their pants to actually make sure that the whole system didn't collapse. But at the same time, I mean, this had been building for a long time. I mean, we had things like, you know, interest-only mortgages being repackaged into, you know, collateralized debt obligations for quite a while, and no one was saying very much of anything. I mean, including Alan Greenspan, you know, was encouraging consumers, you know, to consider, you know, mortgages that adjusted to interest rates. So, you know, again, I would cast if we're going to talk about blame of how we got to this point, I think there were a lot of factors. I would put regulators in there. I would also put, you know, American homeowners who also felt that, you know, that their homes were now an ATM and that you could constantly tap your home equity for other purchases. And, you know, definitely the banks. Also, we had the rating agencies who, frankly, fell down in such an astonishing way in rating these more esoteric instruments, which ended up, you know, being embedded throughout the financial system, like not just in the United States, but, you know, throughout the world. So, you know, again, I think there are a lot of players that, you know, were involved in this mess and that ultimately ended up, you know, creating, you know, these giant financial institutions, which is kind of like, you know, in some ways, a new problem to tackle with, or to tackle, right? Because, you know, they're bigger. They for example, in J.P. Morgan's case, they actually survived the financial crisis. So I think there was a lot of, you know, assumptions that, you know, it's the best managed bank, and therefore we don't need to worry so much about this one. So anyway, I just think, you know, if we're going to cast blame, I think we should think very broadly.
No, that's fair enough. We're getting a more nuanced picture now that it's not just all blaming on the banks. But having said that, right. Brian, let me put this to you. 4 years ago, the behavior, the activities of the biggest banks in the United States were significantly, let's put it that way, we've heard there's others on the list, but were significantly influential in the fact that the Great Recession happened. how much risk do the activities of the biggest banks in the world or on Wall Street today have in the global economy?
Well, I think the frightening answer is that they still are play the same kind of role they did then. Now, it's true that as an economic engine, which drove not just the United States economy but European economies, they are smaller in terms of their impact. But when you look at, say, the derivatives market, which is this multi-trillion dollar market, $200-300 trillion, these five or six big U.S. banks control more than 95% of that market. I mean, that's not only not healthy, but most of that stuff is what Paul Volcker has called side bets. They don't help economies grow. They do help pocketbooks grow. They help bankers make multi-million dollar pay packages. But they do nothing to get the global economy working again. And that's one of the problems that I see with these banks. They're not doing the basic function of banking, which is supposed to be taking depositors' money and lending it out, with good prudence to people who can afford to pay it back. That's the function of banking at its base. And these bankers, of course, on Wall Street, and not just on Wall Street, but in Europe too, decided, hey, we can make millions, millions more if we make all these bets with our own money and with depositors' money and reap way higher returns. So why should we settle for these meager deposit returns when we can get 20 or 30 or 40% and make us rich and our shareholders happy?
We can look like masters of the universe.
Exactly what they wanted to do.
I want to play some tape at this point here, and for our American guests, I'll just set this up a little bit. I'm going to play you some tape of a guy named John Ralston Saul. He's one of Canada's, I guess, most published authors, leading public intellectuals, married to a former Governor General of Canada. And, well, here's what he had to say about some of what we're talking about today. Roll tape, please.
They chose to give the money to the wrong people because they believed the important thing was to keep lending going. Whereas, in fact, there are many ways of doing it. There are many ways of shifting money to people who will actually spend it, like poorer people, middle-class people. They'd actually spend the money. Whereas they gave it to these banks who did not spend it because they were on another game, playing another game, which had nothing to do with the well-being of the society or with growth. They're not interested in the growth of the society. They're interested in something very personal that has to do with their bank.
That full interview to air, as you saw, August 9th, later this summer. Okay, let's get into this. Donald, is he right?
Well, yes. The idea that banks have a basic social function is one I strongly agree with. I happen to think that the finest U.S. Political servant who didn't wear a uniform in my lifetime is Paul Volcker. And the things that he did to save the U.S. economy. And he was the one who set up the Basel system. And if they had stuck to those rules, we didn't lose a big global bank for 12 years after he set this up. And during the time he was Federal Reserve Chairman, he had to deal with lots of ones, including a bank in Chicago, which nearly brought down the system, and the building right next to the one I work out of. So there was a time, believe it or not, when we had a chance to do things right and stay that way. What happened was, after Paul Volcker was marginalized out, they started using the mathematics, one of which was created by a Canadian who won a Nobel Prize for value at risk, as it's called, and they came up with a new set of Basel rules, which they did to start to allow them to lever up and to do all these things which Paul Volcker had ruled out. Paul Volcker said famously that the only socially useful new invention in the banking system in the last 25 years has been the automated teller machine. And so what happened then was we lacked that kind of magisterial leadership to say, why are you doing all this? And so you're absolutely right that part of it was that the governments, everybody was involved because they could see that there was going to be more money and their own banking systems would prosper. But what they did then was they also, for a few years, that a significant percentage of all new PhDs in physics in the U.S. came to Wall Street. And exactly as was commented before, these weren't people with any background in finance. For them, it was all numbers. And in 2007, Nassim Taleb, he and I spoke at a conference. He predicted the total crash was going to come within a year because of bad mathematics. And he referred specifically to black holes. He said the mathematics were wrong, therefore what they're erecting in these gigantic edifices will implode. That's precisely what happened. It was bad physics. In other words, they would have been better off with nuclear bombs, probably, but at least we would have observed them in action. So you had bad physics, you had managements who didn't understand this, and you had governments which wanted to have the banks doing more and more to promote housing. So that's how we got into the mess, because government, there was no longer any opponents. Everybody was on the same side, as it turned out, disastrously for a few years. They rewrote the rules, they gutted them of Paul Volcker's provisions, and then when the crash came, what we had was a combination of folly, foolishness, fraud, but it all started because of the people who were supposedly running the machine didn't even understand the physics that they had within it, and the physics people who were coming up with the physics didn't understand finance. In retrospect, this was a monumental cock-up.
Donald, I can't wait to hear what your next alliteration will be. You've used a couple of them so far, and I've been really impressed. But Brian, out of all of this has come something that the American Congress passed called Dodd-Frank. Take a moment here and just tell us what Dodd-Frank is designed to do.
Well, that was a bill that went through Congress and originally called for quite a strict reform of the entire regulatory system covering financial institutions and even non-financial institutions. It was a very large endeavor. And then, of course, the financial sector spent a fortune getting it watered down, and that, in fact, is what happened. The problem with Dodd-Frank is that it's this massive effort at reform, but all of the reforms have to come at the regulatory level after multiple hearings and years. There are parts of that Dodd-Frank that were approved that we won't see until 2015 or 2017 or even later because of how long it takes to get these regulations printed, studied, and approved at each of these regulatory bodies. And there are many of them, and they all have, they compete for turf in the United States viciously. So that's what's happened. And that's why the banks are pretty much on side with what's left of Dodd-Frank, because they got rid of the stuff they didn't want.
Hmm. Paul, is that to say that because it's going to take so long to implement, it actually won't have very much impact?
Well, I think it would be incorrect to say that it won't have very much impact because of its size. I mean, Dodd-Frank is, I think it's like over 240 rules. There's 60 different reports, a number of different studies that they've mandated. It's just going to take a very long time to unwind it. But I think, again, I want to go back to something that Donald said, and I tried to talk about a little bit earlier, and that is, whose voice was predominant in this period? And Volcker's voice was eclipsed by essentially the poster boy for free markets, and that was Alan Greenspan. And it was really the decision to move away from regulated markets, to embrace the idea that it's really up to the individual to take the risk that comes with markets, and that at the end of the day, that regulators really ought not to have a role, that the best SEF regulators are companies. And of course, this has turned out to be a complete nonsense. And the other thing and this is something that Brian touched on, is whether or not banks are really public goods. So if you think about a car industry, if you think about a consumer electronics industry or a food company, I mean, that's one kind of company, and you need certain kinds of regulation to make sure that those companies aren't hurting people. But are banks something a little bit different because of the importance that they play in driving the economy? And that was lost when Volcker passed out of the scene. And it really became an ideology that most countries embraced with both hands. And, you know, who were the great heroes of the 1990s into the early part of the 21st century? And it was people who were working in financial services, making huge amounts of money. You know, again, these kind of masters of the universe. And I think the third thing is, and Dodd-Frank tries to deal with this, although not as well as it might have, which is the issue of leverage. And really the way a bank works, it did prior to 1980, was it took basically $1 of asset, and then it lent it out to a factor of about 10 times. And it turned out that a 10-to-1 ratio was about the right number to prevent the bank collapses that characterized the 1930s and the kind of things we saw after 2008. The leverage in the financial system as we headed to 2007, 2008 was closer, some of these companies, like Citibank, for example, as high as 40 to 1. And there's lots of history that that's not sustainable. So the, one of the key measuring sticks of whether Dodd-Frank is going to work, or whether regulators have really got control of this problem, is the leverage issue, whether we're going to see banks back to a kind of 10 to 1 ratio in terms of their assets and their capital.
Well, Agnes, we know Paul Volcker's a big deal because he's got a rule named after him now. Mm-hmm. Can you help us understand what the Volcker rule is designed to speak to?
Yeah, I mean, the Volcker rule essentially is to, you know, separate, you know, customer deposits from so-called prop trading, you know, bets that the banks put on, you know, for their own book. You know, and I would say, you know, the fact that the Volcker rule is part of Dodd-Frank, we still don't have the final regulations. I mean, I think it's having a bit of an impact on the banks as they're trying to kind of sort this out. But again, I think what we're, you know, just the complexity of banks and the idea of trying to, you know, kind of regulate them, you're really seeing that with the Volcker rule. You know, because essentially what banks do is they make markets, right? So say I am, you know, I'm somebody who wants to buy a corporate bond. I may go through a bank who may be have that corporate bond in their inventory and they'll sell it to me. With the Volcker rule, it gets very, the line between market making and actual prop trading is a pretty fuzzy one. And I think that's what, you know, the Federal Reserve and the other regulators are starting to try to grapple with. You know, first of all, is it even possible to draw a bright line here? And again, I think, you know, some of the frustrations around the Volcker rule, either from the regulators or from the banks, you know, there's, you're hearing people talk more and more about, you know, the simplicity of bringing back like a modern day Glass-Steagall, I think, because again, like this idea of trying to take these incredibly complex institutions and try to regulate them, you know, with something that seems like it's an easy, you know, a simple idea, which is, you know, separate, you know, government backed deposits from prop trading, and then you find out it's actually quite difficult to do. So, you know, I think we're still in this very evolving place with regulation, and even with Dodd-Frank, I mean, the Federal Reserve has already said they're going to blow past their deadline, which was supposed to be next month, and trying to kind of craft these rules. It's just getting flooded with, you know, it's getting flooded with comments not just from the banks, but from foreign governments who are afraid that their trading of, like, say, you know, the Deutsche Germany's Bund may be affected, for example. So we'll have to see how some of these things play out.
You talked about Glass-Steagall there, and let me just go to Donald on that for a second. Glass-Steagall, of course, going back to the Depression, an attempt to separate a bank's investment from its commercial activities. And I wonder how realistic you think the calls are to sort of reinstate that kind of thinking on the financial sector today.
Well, it's always difficult to achieve retroactive virginity, but if there were a case for trying to carry off this miracle, I believe it should be done with the banking system, because Dodd-Frank is 2,200 pages, and each page has rules which then have regulations which have to be analyzed. So far, the only economic contribution it's made is it has employed hundreds and hundreds of lawyers and accountants, maybe thousands. So those sectors of the economy, which didn't need all that help in the recession, have profited hugely from this. And in general, you know, the Constitution of the United States runs to only a few pages. So the fact that all this is being done in the banking system, and the fact that the success for banks will be to what extent they can wiggle through the rules of this, what it means is we are misdirecting such good intellectual energy as still exists within the Wall Street system. That shouldn't be something that the bright people like Lloyd Blankfein are doing. So I realized that something had to be done after this, and it's because they refused to say we'll go back to Glass-Steagall, which would have meant basically that we'd have the investment banks separated out, but Jamie Dimon wasn't going to let that happen, and he was too well connected. So if they are not going to do that, then they've got to have a few simple rules, frankly, and say, we're not going to let you violate these.
Period. You brought up Jamie Dimon there, and Brian, since you raised the issue, I guess, a few moments ago about the $2 billion loss his company sustained.
Well, that's the minimum. It will be more.
It will be more. But now this happened. This he's considered the king of Wall Street. He's the most successful guy. He's got a powerhouse of an outfit that he's on top of. He was, you know, one of the big heroes who came in and sort of saved the day that the Treasury Secretary met with all those years ago. But this happened in London. And I wonder whether the ability to play, I mean, if you can do business outside of the United States, how exactly are any regulations passed by the United States government supposed to prevent this kind of shenanigans?
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, one of the reasons that happened in London is because there were no concerns about proprietary trading. And in fact, it's been said that the British government would love to clamp down on some of these activities in London, but London is such an important financial center and such a big contributor to the British economy, far more than Wall Street is to the U.S. economy, that they won't shut it down because then they'll see all that stuff move to Singapore or somewhere else. So the fact is, it says something about the ethics of these bankers, that they're already saying how they're going to get around these rules if you dare pass them. You know, instead of saying, we will behave better if you just leave us alone, they're saying, do what you want and we'll get around it because we always have in the past. in Jamie Dimon's case, I mean, he does wear this halo because, you know, he absorbed Bear Stearns, even though his bank profited from that deal. And he was involved in the famous kitchen cabinet discussions on how to save Lehman. What people forget is that, of course, he ran out and called all of his people at J.P. Morgan and told them to stop trading with Lehman immediately while Lehman was still trying to survive. So Jamie Dimon looked after himself and his bank very well.
Was that considered rude to have done?
Well, I mean, if he was really interested
in... Not to Lehman.
Yeah, no kidding.
They didn't like Lehman, they hated Lehman's guts because Lehman was a competitor that they felt didn't play by their old boys' rules. And the fact is that they were very happy to see Bear Stearns and Lehman go because both of those banks caused a lot of grief for their competitors.
Paul, let me try this one with you. We got into a good list earlier of you know, who some of the villains are in this piece. And one thing we haven't touched much on, I mean, yes, homeowners, yes, the Treasury Secretary, yes, the ratings agencies, yes, the regulators, of course, yes, the banks. But I wonder whether or not there's been a truly frank, and I don't mean Barney Frank, I mean a candid assessment of the role that American politicians played in all of this because of their eagerness to relax the standards by which loans could be let to people so they could buy those houses. How about that as an underpinning for some of what went down?
Well, you know, when this was all blowing up in 2008 and 2009, and then the blame game and the pointing game started, there were some Republican politicians who blamed the Clinton administration. They had a Hispanic housing cabinet minister whose name escapes me, who
Henry
really
Cisneros,
pushed
I think.
To make. Thank you, Henry Cisneros, to make the access to housing easier for lower income Americans, but. Again, this goes back to the point that this was the flavor of the times. You know, the market was always right, the invisible hand of the market. The state is wrong. The things that people worshipped at the feet of politicians like Reagan and Thatcher. So everyone was part of that. Everyone was part of that conversation. Again, at that moment that the regulatory impulse of the state collapsed, you had this rise of financial services and the development of new financial service technologies like credit derivatives and credit default swaps and the rest, at the same time that other technological changes around information and communication made it easier to make this not only a national industry, a regional industry, but a global industry. But at the end of the day, me being the only one that's actually worked at Lehman Brothers on this panel in Tokyo for a couple of years. I mean, when we walked in the morning, it's about making as much money as you possibly can in the shortest period of time. And what happened between 1980 and 2008, and still exists to some extent, is that the risk and rewards were skewed wrong. The investment banks and the people who worked in them and who are paid, again, to make as much money in the shortest period of time as they possibly can, they got all of the reward, a lot of the reward, but they and the institution did not carry the risk. And what we found out in 2007 and 2008, and it still exists today, is that the taxpayer carries the risk of those financial institutions. And that's really the crux of the problem. And I was on your show a couple of years ago and we talked about moral hazard. Mm-hmm. And the moral hazard extends not only to people who put their money in banks because they know that their deposits are protected by the government, so they don't really go into too much effort to find out whether or not the bank that they're putting their money in is solvent or not. Similarly, the moral hazard that extends to traders who come in the morning and are basically trying to make as much money as they possibly can. That's really the crux of the problem. And I think the collapse of financial markets and the impact it had on the global economy in 2008 and 2009 and the rise of issues around inequality, this is changing the conversation and making people much less prepared to accept the kind of Greenspan oracle, the Ayn Rand way of thinking about how societies are best organized. That's really where we're trying to get to. And the challenge then is, do you need a 2,000 plus page document like Dodd-Frank, or do you just need a couple of pages like the American Constitution to steer us in the right direction? And I think that's really the challenge we have right now. And of course, we are talking about the United States. Canada actually has a lot of this stuff in place. Canada's not immune to some of these problems, but what we don't have is 40-year mortgages. What we don't have is Canadians, we still have a lot of evidence of it, using their houses as ATM machines. Although I have heard, partly in preparation for today, the Canadians that are getting pretty good terms on their mortgages are actually going out and using the money they should be using to pay off their mortgage to buy bigger cars. So the day of reckoning may even happen in a country like Canada as well. Hmm.
You talked about compensation in the middle of that answer, and I want to follow up on that and read you something that we're calling All Hail the Wall Street Bonus. This is from Gabriel Sherman of New York Magazine from earlier this year. On Wall Street, bonus season is a sacred ritual. It is the annual rite where net worth and self-worth get elegantly reduced to a single number. During the 25-year boom that abruptly ended in 2008, the only principle that really mattered come bonus time was how you ranked against the guys to your right and left. The system was governed by a kind of atavistic justice. You eat what you kill. From the outside, the 7- and 8-figure payouts that star bankers earned could seem obscene, immoral even. But on the inside, the outlandish compensation reflected a strict, almost moral logic. Wall Street is a meritocracy for the most part. If someone has a bonus, it's because they created value for their institution. The sanctity of the bonus was built on the idea that Wall Street pay was simply the natural order of capitalism. Agnes, let's get into this. Can the culture and expectations around compensation on Wall Street ever be changed?
Well, I mean, I think we're already starting to see some change. You know, whether it's enough, I think it has further to go, right? But I mean, in terms of compensation, the one metric people look at is compensation as a percentage of revenue. That's come down a bit. We also now have clawbacks. You know, if you make money and get a big bonus, and then it comes out later that you actually, you know, did something wrong, they can actually go after the bonus. So, I mean, I think that, you know, that'll help. And, I really think what we're seeing with banks right now is, you know, profitability is down, right? I mean, we have an interest rate environment in which it's very difficult for banks to make big money without leverage, right? It's starting to dawn on people in the banks that the kind of bonuses that they had become accustomed to during the boom, that era is over. So, you know, again, you know, whether it's going to be enough, we'll see. And, you know, and what is the right bonus for some of these traders, for example? I mean, that's an open question. But, you know, I think, you know, we can say at least there is, you know, at the margin, I mean, stuff is, you know, that it's improved a bit.
Donald, I want to follow up with you because we know that a lot of the TARP money, that, you know, Troubled Asset Relief Program money that went to supposedly help banks' balance sheets look better, ended up going strictly in bonuses to a lot of these Wall Street titans. And I think there's a technical financial sector term for that. I think it's called chutzpah. Do they not see it that way?
Yeah, well, there's no question that the big one came, of course, at the case of Merrill Lynch when it was being passed around and eventually being absorbed by Bank of America, which was the single worst decision in the history of Bank of America. And so, but frankly, by the time we'd gotten to that stage, the system was already sort of healing And those extra bonuses were adding insult to the injuries, but it's the injuries that are more important. I agree with Agnes that going forward, there's going to be much more concern about that. But the fact that Citigroup was allowed to operate by the same balance sheet rules that Enron had, which was having these special purpose entities off the balance sheet, so you didn't know how levered they were. And Enron had gone down, and instead of that being a model to be worried about, you had Chuck Prince dancing and everything. They were still using those kinds of accounting things. Now, it's getting to those things that we've got to make sure, and I agree with the earlier comments, that getting back to a better leverage position is more important, frankly, than anything else. And that means going at those accounting where they can get these other things off the books. And if you do that, you take away the chance of these people being able to get bonuses of the kind that go beyond the word obscene.
Brian, let me put a couple of developments to you. I gather earlier this year, Morgan Stanley announced that they're going to cap bonuses at $125,000. Other investment banks may be following suit. In Europe, they are set to actually pass a law, I guess, regulating the size of bonus relative to what your salary is. What do you think of what appears to be, anyway, a trend?
Well, there's no question that they understand that the public backlash is being translated into a political problem for them, and that's what they really care about. Especially in an election year in the United States, bank bashing is always popular anyway on the hustings. So this just gives one more lever to politicians who can make some headway on this. But the fact is that if you look at where the banks focus most of their lobbying attention, it's not on giving more bonuses to worthy bankers, it's on keeping these other regulations at bay, including the leverage stuff, so that they can continue to make outsized amounts of money, because that's how they function. The fact is that if you don't pay big bonuses to big earners, they leave. And nowadays, they set up hedge funds, and they become what's known as shadow banks, and they do a lot of the same stuff they did inside your bank, but they get to keep the profits. And that's something that Wall Street has not come to terms with, and I think it's a serious problem that they face, because it costs a great deal of money to keep the kind of talent around that's fed that profit machine for so many years.
Sounds like the average guy, who after all, whose taxes went to bail out these folks after their bad behavior, sounds like he or she can't win.
Well, look at the example of J.P. Morgan, where the head of the investment office, who was responsible for the trader that made those horrible bets, she was a 30-year lifer at J.P. Morgan. She was making a perfectly good wage, but then she discovered, under Jamie Dimon's direction, by the way, to expand the value of that fund, she discovered that she could make a heck of a lot more money if she let these traders do what they wanted. And her salary, her income, bonus and salary, went up to about $14 million or $15 million. Plus, of course, she got another big payout when she took that forced retirement. So if you're a banker sitting in New York and you say, you know, I could work my whole life and maybe I'll get up to $1 million or $2 million, but I can do this and I can make $14 or $15 million. I don't have to have such a long career.
What are people who are living in St. Louis, well, let's take the Peoria, Illinois. What are they to make of all of this, you know?
Sure, go ahead. Well, I just want to jump in. I mean, there's nothing wrong with getting a $1 million bonus or a $50 million bonus. The state has absolutely no place in determining how much people make.
Unless it's
their
money.
As Brian said, what'll happen? Well, it's not a question of how much money you make. The point is that it's the role of the state to determine the leverage in the banking system that makes it an industry that is not going to be bailed out by taxpayers. It's got to go back to basic fundamentals about what the role of a bank is. And it has everything to do with getting the leverage right. Again, back to kind of 10-to-1 ratio. Kind of pop ways of dealing with this problem by passing legislation telling how much someone can make is a big mistake. The state doesn't belong there. The state belongs in making clear decisions about the kind of leverage that belongs in a financial institution. That's the key to getting this problem under control.
Agnes, you got any problem with that?
No, I mean, I agree with that. I mean, I think we've already seen that, like, since the crisis. I mean, I think leverage has come down. I think capital, you know, and capital cushions are also, I mean, I think that all, building up capital, I think that also is helpful. But, you know, I mean, I guess the other, you know, I know we were talking about compensation, but I still feel like at the end of the day, I mean, you can do all this, but when you have banks as big as not just the U.S., but I mean some of the banks in Europe are also, you know, gigantic. When you have them that big, I think it still does, even, you know, even with leverage, you know, coming down, I still think it becomes problematic if they make, you know, a big mistake.
Okay, let me play this tape here, and I'm going to actually put a warning out here. You're going to hear some language in this that is probably not fit for children, although probably most children know this language. But here's Paul Bettany, and 38 seconds later, we'll come back and talk about whether or not there's a bit of hypocrisy around bank criticism. Roll tape, please.
Listen, if you really want to do this with your life, you have to believe you're necessary, and you are. People want to live like this in their cars and their big fucking houses they can't even pay for. Then you're necessary. The only reason that they all get to continue living like kings is because we've got our fingers on the scales in their favor. I take my hand off. When then the whole world gets really fucking fair, really fucking quickly, and nobody actually wants that. They say they do, but they don't. They want what we have to give them, but they also want to, you know, play innocent and pretend they have no idea where it came from. Well, that's more hypocrisy than I'm willing to swallow, so fuck. Fuck normal people.
Okay, Donald Cox, that's a little clip from the movie Margin Call. Does he make a point?
I'm afraid that sound quality didn't carry through with me. You better get one of the people who was closer to it.
Well, you know what? I'm not going to repeat it for you. I'm not going to repeat it for you.
Yeah, I didn't expect that, yeah.
Brian, you want to take a kick at that?
Somebody else can handle that one.
Okay.
Well, that's the Masters of the Universe line, right? Who wants to be ordinary? I didn't become an engineer at some manufacturing company in Skokie, Illinois, because I could make millions on Wall Street and retire by the time I'm 40 to my yacht. That's the mentality. That's the kind of people who are attracted to the business, and they're attracted for the action. It's a gambling business. That part of it is all about gambling, and banking at its core should not be about gambling, because as Dono knows, you can't actually measure risk. He talked about value at risk models that were imposed by all of these banks, including the ones that went way off beam, but you can't measure it, and they had no business trying.
With just a few minutes to go, Donald, let me try this, since I hope my voice sounds a little better than the one from the motion picture clip there. Let's try this. Here's Matt Taibbi writing in Rolling Stone. All those thousands of hours of debate and fierce negotiations spent hammering out Dodd-Frank 2 years ago might now go up in smoke in a matter of a few quiet minutes. Of the big ticket items that were actually passed 2 years ago, the derivatives reforms have been completely gutted by loopholes. The Volcker Rule has been delayed for 2 years, and the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau may be thrust under the budgetary control of Congress, which is determined to destroy it. And much of this is taking place with the assent of Democrats, for a very simple reason. Because the name of the game isn't cleaning up Wall Street, it's cleaning out Wall Street. Throwing a yes vote at a bank-approved bill to get them to pony up in an election year. All this is aimed at the financial services industry, admits one senior Democratic congressional aide. It's to let them know, hey, you're okay. We're not going to destroy your business and give us your money because we're trying to raise it for an election. I mean, Donald, that's a pretty cynical appraisal of things, but is it right?
It's got so much going for it because of the mere fact of the 2,200 pages of the bill. Because as by definition, if you keep on going through all that, when you're trying to prescribe what is right, then they're going to find wrong, they're going to find ways around it. Whereas if you had a few pages of the thou shalt not or you get put out of business, they would have stopped it. So this is one of the things, this country has more lawyers than the rest of the OECD, I think, put together. That's the biggest problem in the U.S. economy. I say that as a former lawyer. And so naturally, when they try to go at a thing like this with lawyers, what they are going to do is definitely not rule out the really bad practices because there will be an exemption found for it. So, for example, in the Eurozone, what they need to do is say that these banks are not going to buy government bonds outside their own country. As it is, they have to prop them all up now because they're a bunch of drunks propping each other, bad countries and bad banks. One law would have prevented that from happening, one simple law.
Agnes, I got a minute left here. Do you think the outcome of the 2012 presidential election in the United States could affect Wall Street?
You know, actually, I think it's not going to be the election itself. I think the United States is actually facing something far more serious, which is this fiscal cliff, in which a lot of legislation is running off, like the Bush tax cuts and tax credits. And it's basically how that's going to be dealt with in the lame duck Congress that I think is probably going to have the biggest impact, not just on Wall Street, but on the economy.
Gotcha. That's going to be the last word today. Thanks, everybody, very much for your help on this topic. Donald Cox from Chicago, BMO Financial Group. Agnes Crane from New York City, the columnist with Reuters Breaking Views. Paul Somerville, friend of the program, I can call you that, out in Victoria, B.C. for the University of Victoria. And I guess another friend of the program. Brian Miller, you've only been coming to these parts for about, I don't know, 16, 17 years.
So. I think of this as a friendly place to be.
Okay, good enough. From the Globe and Mail, of course.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.